Stefon Diggs is now a member of the Houston Texans. According to Adam Schefter, here are the details of the trade. The Bills receive a 2025 second round pick, which was the Minnesota Vikings prior to that. The Texans receive Stefon Diggs, a 2024 sixth rounder, and a 2025 fifth round pick. Hayden, my conclusions are twofold. One, the Houston Texans can do this when you have pillar positions on rookie deals. CJ Stroud, Nico Collins, Tank Dell, Derek Stingley, Will Anderson. And it certainly feels like the Buffalo Bills were just done with the Stefon Diggs and Stingley experiment.
We react to all news on this channel, but this is one that actually moves the needle for both sides, kind of a state of the franchise on each side. Starting with the Bills, they are eating $31 million, and they're actually paying $3 million this year to trade him away for basically peanuts, only a second-round pick in the future. It's not going to help them this year address the wide receiver position. They don't have a third-round pick as well. They're probably going to use the 20th overall pick and 60th overall picks to find wide receivers, but this was something that I didn't see fully coming. But after the Bills kind of reset this offseason, cutting a lot of veterans on the offensive line, they got rid of Gabe Davis. They didn't seem to be in the market for him. The defense looks a whole lot different now. This is kind of a reset year for the Buffalo Bills, and like you said, the Texans have all the ammo to pull this thing off just because you have CJ Stroud coming off of a rookie of the year season.
Yeah, and again, all those other players at important positions that people pay a bunch of money for are all on rookie contracts, and that's to go along with the moves that they made for like Danielle Hunter in free agency. Let's take this from the Houston Texans angle, okay? What does Stefon Diggs bring to a Texans organization that obviously made the playoffs last year after a not difficult start, but a slow start because you're changing so many pieces and coaching staff members? You know, this was already a young, promising wide receiver duo in Nico Collins and Tank Dell. And now, Hayden, is it as simple as adding Stefon Diggs makes this the best wide receiver trio in the NFL?
I think it does. It also helps both Steph Diggs and Tank Dell. Tank Dell is coming off of an injury similar to Tony Pollard, who didn't have the same explosiveness this last year. I think that the Steph Diggs trade makes him not need Tank Dell immediately to kind of slow play him if his injury is kind of lingering. It also, I think, might help Steph Diggs to not be like the true alpha anymore as he's kind of aging past his prime. Last season was his worst season in a long time. And I think that we're going to have to debate if that was because of the new offense or because Steph Diggs might not have the same step. Well, if he was only seeing 7-8 targets in this offense rather than like 10 targets per game, I think it's going to be very helpful. And I think for Steph Diggs, when he was really cooking, it wasn't just because he was winning within 10 yards of the line of scrimmage. To me, he was one of the best downfield threats in the league for multiple seasons in a row. He actually has the second most targets on 15 plus air yards since 2020. It's him and then ironically Justin Jefferson, who's basically traded for with the Vikings back in the day. And that's what this Texans offense does. It's a lot of play action shots, working deep over the middle, big post routes, big crossing routes, just go balls on the perimeter. To me, that's where Steph Diggs, when we loved Steph Diggs 3, 4, 5 years ago, that's where he was completely dominating the league.
There's a lot to unpack there. First, yes, he turns 31 years of age this November, okay? He had 0 100-yard games over his final 13 of this past season. There's other underlying metrics, if you want to look at them, that point to Stefon Diggs was on the decline, right? I can also say, hey, the Bills last year underwent a lot of change. Halfway through the season, they fired their offensive coordinator. They went kind of all in, including this extension for Stefon Diggs. Mm-hmm. And ever since, it really has not worked. I mean, you fire again the offensive coordinator, keep Joe Brady in that spot. You move on from, I would say, like the core of that locker room, which was both safeties and the identities of the defense. We talked about Gabe Davis. And so, I mean, when I can also look at 2022 and Stefon Diggs just at that time had a full green route chart according to Matt Harmon's success route percentage, like he was for long stretches of time the Bills' wide receiver core. He was their passing game, you know? And I'm with you where this is a player who we can see line up at X. We can see him line up at Z. We can see him line up in the slot. In fact, there have been times in his career where it's been about 33% in each of those occasions. We know where Nico Collins is going to line up for this Houston Texans team. Yep. What this allows Bobby Slowick to do is to interchange and exchange Stefon Diggs and Tank Dell on the outside and the inside to go along with that max protection, heavy, deep play action sets and attacking the vertical nature in the middle of the field of defenses. This is like a win-win scenario, I think, for both, depending on what the priorities were for both. But this definitely makes the Houston Texans like legit contenders. And again, one of the most fun offenses in the league.
Super fun. I think it's going to be a little bit frustrating for fantasy football, not for CJ Stroud, who's like very much in that kind of Joe Burrow mix around round five for me. But it's Steph Diggs and Tank Dell, in my opinion, trying to battle for these two wide receiver set routes. And that's going to be the key part, because last year the Texans were only 23rd in three wide receiver set rate. Now that's going to go up, obviously, when you have, you're basically replacing Robert Woods and Noah Brown with Steph Diggs. You're going to use more three wide receiver sets. But a huge function of this offense is those max protection, play action, deep shots, and they were fantastic at them. So I don't think you're going to completely remove those. I'm going to guess Steph Diggs starts ahead of Tank Dell. So I think this is going to, if somebody's like negatively affected the most, I think it's probably Tank Dell, who is being drafted in like around round three on Underdog. I think that he has to slide down a couple rounds just because I think that Steph Diggs is a candidate being those two wide receiver sets. I think my prediction is Nico Collins is still going to be the most productive player ahead of Steph Diggs. I think it's just kind of a changing of the guard. Just what I've seen from Nico Collins is fantastic stuff. And then Steph Diggs kind of trending in the wrong direction. I think the consistency is not going to be there for Steph Diggs anymore, but I think that he will have a little bounce back, maybe in these like ability to use, like you said, 100-yard games, just because we're going to see some 40, 50-yard catches again.
Just quickly, because of his size, I feel like, and we were guilty of this last preseason, believing that Tank Dell is mainly going to be a slot wide receiver in the NFL. That was not the case last year for the Houston Texans, and he starred on the outside as a guy who, you know, again, on these 10-plus-yard routes, putting defensive backs on their heels and then cutting off of that and playing bigger than his size. He only played slot about 29% of the time. That's, again, even lower than Stefon Diggs' 36% and the Nico Collins around 20%. Again, you have this interchangeableness. And I do wonder if this does shift the Bobby Slowick stuff, because we talked about last year, they, you know, had Andrew Beck out there. They had Eric Seibert out there as another tight end to go along with Dalton Schultz. And so along with keeping the running back in, it would turn into 7-8 man protections at times. I do wonder if improved offensive line might lead to more of these three wide receiver sets over and over and over again. Because you certainly don't want to, let's say, aggravate who Stefon Diggs is at this moment, because we have seen him now force himself off two teams. He did it with the Minnesota Vikings to the Buffalo Bills. Now he's kind of done it with the Buffalo Bills to the Houston Texans. And I mean, just last night, responding on Twitter from a person named the Peaky Pirate, does Josh Allen benefit from having a top tier wide receiver? Yes. Is he essential to his success? No. And Stefon Diggs just responding with, you sure? Question mark. So look, Stefon Diggs wears his emotions on his sleeve. You can see that on the sideline. Very well known, his cryptic tweets out there. But if you talk about situation and fit and a young quarterback going from great to great in that aspect and a really good play caller and a team that can contend right now for the division title, this is a perfect home for
him. Perfect home for him. I don't want to like be too prisoner of the moment, but I think with this trade, I think the Texans can go on kind of that Bengals Super Bowl run with Joe Burrow ascending quarterback and CJ Stroud. I mean, how could you not love what CJ Stroud did last year? It's kind of like the little cherry on top for that to really pay off. The defense looks a little bit more complete this year. Will Anderson and going into his second season, D'Amico Ryan's in his second season. So yeah, this is a little firepower for it. And then for the Texans side, it looks like they're going to keep him for $18 million this year. And then I believe there's no guaranteed money in these future years. So if Steph Diggs doesn't completely bounce back, like we kind of think that he might in this offense, they don't have to commit to him long-term either.
Yeah, it's an Amari Cooper-esque deal when he joined from Dallas to Cleveland. And that was what, for a fifth round pick. So much different in terms of compensation, but how you can obviously still play without that guaranteed money, even though Stefon Diggs might want some. The Texans still have 2 second round picks too, 42nd, 59th overall. Let's finish this video out with what this means for the Buffalo Bills. The Curtis Samuel signing was very different in terms of a talent and a role player than what they lost in Gabriel Davis. And we kind of questioned that dynamic of how do Diggs, Curtis Samuel, and Khalil Shakir all fit in that same wide receiver room. Makes a little bit more sense now because I think they'll end up doing Curtis Samuel into the Stefon Diggs outside to inside role a bit more often. That's my read on it.
Right.
But my big concern is this team, when drafting Dalton Kincaid last year, wanted to be 11 and a half personnel. They said it. And then in the first half to three quarters of the season, that just did not work. The efficiency metrics, the success rates were just like really bad. And now they have to lean into that even more. They obviously are not done adding pieces, but they were already down weapons around Josh Allen, and he was already having to play hero mode maybe more than almost any other quarterback in the league. And so now I'm just highly intrigued of what this team does, because while they did go all in and this feels like a mini reset, they still definitely have enough talent to contend and a quarterback that's going to put them in the picture no matter what.
It's asking a whole lot for Josh Allen at this point. I think the roster is like probably mediocre at this point around Josh Allen, who's probably the second best or third best player in the entire league. But I think it's asking a lot. And you're right. This is kind of a double down on the two tight end set as the foundation. And last year's results were pretty mediocre. And I think that's one of the reasons why they had to make an offensive coordinator change. When we did the Curtis Samuel breakdown, I thought that Joe Brady was going to use him how he did back with the Panthers, where he was kind of the gadget guy, manufactured touches behind the line of scrimmage, a lot of slot snaps. Well, now he's going back out to the outside for now. And last year he ran six routes in two wide receiver sets. So now you're asking him to do something that he hasn't done in a little bit of time. And you're missing the number one outside wide receiver and a potential like dirty work, big X wide receiver in Gabe Davis. So, I mean, Khalil Shakir and Curtis Samuel, plus this kind of two tight end stuff, that is not a good recipe. Right. Obviously, they might trade up for like Brian Thomas, A.D. Mitchell's there. Even Ladd McConkey could win on the outside, kind of in that 28th overall range. And I wouldn't rule out them double dipping at 28th and 60th overall, but they don't have a third round pick. And they are really desperate for a true wide receiver, because I think Curtis Samuel's probably best in the slot. I know he's had some success from time to time on the perimeter, but I think he is a slot wide receiver, and you're probably asking too much. I think it's too much of a finesse offense if you're doing Dalton Kincaid, Dawson Knox, and then Curtis Samuel, and then whoever they draft in round one or two.
And my thoughts on that 11.5 personnel stuff, it's not necessarily a criticism on Dalton Kincaid, because it's quite difficult, as we've seen, to come in and make a massive impact as a rookie tight end. It was just more of how defenses started playing them and just treating him as a wide receiver, and then they couldn't maximize off of that enough. Like, it was more about the success as a team overall versus the individual player of Dalton Kincaid. That can improve here, but also at the same time, we saw this team bring in Latavius Murray and Leonard Fournette last year to work alongside James Cook, and they don't have that power back on the roster right now opposite James Cook, and they still don't trust him inside the 10-yard line. So still a ton of questions, and this opens up another door to answer another question of who this Bills team is going to be.
And they lost Mitch Morris, their center. They cut him this offseason. So that's another veteran that's not part of this team. So I think this is a full reset year for Josh Allen and the Bills, which sucks. You're right in the prime of your career. You've been close at times, and I think they're going to take a step down this year, but they're at least absorbing a lot of the dead money this year. Maybe if they can hit on this wide receiver, they can kind of reset and go into this the second or third era of Josh Allen. I think we had the Josh Allen where he was a mess, up and down, super flashy. The defense was decent. Then we had the peak Josh Allen teams from like two, three years ago.
Right.
And now we're into this third wave. It's a reset season. And now it's time to go hit on these draft picks again.
It really is the third phase, because first year Josh Allen did not have Stefon Diggs, and there were major questions. And then you brought him in and it took everyone up a level. Mm-hmm. And now you have to figure out who you are as a passing offense without the dude that took you up that level. But we see the great quarterbacks of all time going through these phases, right? Because the pieces change around them, the coaching staff changes around you, and you have to reset. You have to figure out how to be successful even without those same pieces.
All right, this is a fantasy football podcast. I must ask you, put you on the spot. Rank Nico Collins, Diggs, Tank Dell in fantasy for next season.
I know, and I'm a huge Nico Collins fan as well. I just want to remind people that there were games when both played where Tank Dell was more productive than Nico Collins. But I would rank it Nico, Diggs, Tank Dell.
Okay, fair enough.
But I think the larger question is where in the overall spots do they go? Because I could say previously Nico then Tank Dell, but both being drafted in the top 48 overall picks, and now having all three drafted in the top 48 makes it for a very difficult discussion that we're going to have a lot of this summer.
If I had to just kind of spitball it, I think that Nico Collins, he was like an early second round pick. I think I'll probably put him at the 2-3 border now. Steph Diggs, a third round pick. I make him like a fourth round pick. And I think Tank Dell drops probably like three rounds or so, just because I
Tank's already running, man. He's already working out. He's already doing all that stuff.
But we're talking about people last year were already mad that they weren't passing the ball enough. And now we have a third guy, Dalton Schultz back. Joe Mixon's involved now. So,
and I don't think they're getting away from that. I know the nerds. With the first and second down run rate efficiency and all that type of stuff. That is a core belief, I believe, of this style of an offense.
It's the 49ers. It's the same staff, and now you have three weapons and not enough footballs to go around, so we're going to have to be playing this kind of...
But when they do throw the football, it's going to be electric. Nice. It's going to be electric. You can't double cover three wide receivers. Okay, that does it. Again, we already have a Curtis Samuel video here on this channel. And in fact, we are deep in the depths of NFL draft season. So we are going through all these wide receiver prospects. So you Bills fans, you probably need to watch those videos, read up on them. So go and subscribe to the channel. The more of you that subscribe to the channel, the more cool stuff we get to do. So take a moment, hit that button, hit that thumbs up, and we'll check you on the next one.